If you have your Bibles or devices, get them out. If you would, go to the book of John, please. Is that a good book? All right. Say, go to John. He said, oh, yeah. It's good to see all of you here today. Your smiling faces. I'm excited to share this word. We're going to be in John chapter 21. We won't go there yet. I want to lay a little bit of groundwork before we get into this. Redemption and restoration, if I have a title today, is what I want to call this discussion, if you will. This encouragement that I believe God laid on me, even in the middle of the night last night. And one of the most valuable things I believe in life is redemption and restoration. How many would agree with that? That's pretty valuable, isn't it? How many's ever been redeemed this morning? You've all been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, so y'all ought to have your hand up right now. I've been redeemed. Say, I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. All right. And he's in the middle of restoring me. God's a God of restoration. Redemption and restoration are the topic that I want to talk about today. I remember as a kid, one of the most powerful things that my dad taught me as a kid growing up, we were working one time, and he just, we were laying carpet, actually, when he told me this. Dad used to lay carpet for years and when I was young, and we were laying carpet one day, and he said, when you're working or doing a job, you have to learn to fix mistakes, because you will make mistakes sometimes, and you have to fix it. Amen? I just want to shout that to the world today. How many realize that if you make mistakes, you need to fix them? Now stay with me. You're saying, boy, you're getting kind of hard right off the bat. No, I'm going to get in your stuff, because he kept me up half the night last night, and so I'm going to wear you out with it. But it's a truth. Too many times people have the mindset, they start something, they screw it up, and then they just leave it or just quit. I got to be careful. No matter what it is, and please stay with me and hone in with me this morning, because we're going to go somewhere. When you're doing a job, you are bound to make mistakes. Why? Because you're human. Amen? You're going to do something wrong. You're going to misjudge something. You're going to not pay attention to something, and you're going to do something wrong. But how many know you don't just leave it and let somebody else fix it? You fix it. Amen? And you have to learn how to fix things, because you're going to make mistakes. And he told me a story one time of a mistake that he made laying carpet. And there was no other carpet. And let me know, when you cut carpet wrong, you got to seam it back together. You got to fix it, because if that's the only piece you have for that particular house or job, you can't just run and get another piece, because sometimes they don't match. And so that's what he was teaching me about, or using that for an illustration. Have you ever made a mistake in your life? Anybody? About half of you. The rest of you, go and get some humble pie this morning. Ever made a mistake? Yeah. Have you ever made a mistake that you thought, I went too far this time? Or I've screwed this up and I can't fix it? Tell your neighbor, that's a good place to be. Yeah. I know, Pastor, you just said I have to fix it. Now you said it's good that I can't fix it. Amen. Amen. I've screwed this up too far to fix, and I want to talk to someone this morning who messed up really bad one time. I want to talk about someone else who messed up really bad one time. Matter of fact, they messed up several times. It's John chapter 21. We'll be there in a minute, but the last connection, I'm going to be talking about Peter this morning. Let's go ahead and read John 21, verse 15. If you could scroll on down to 15, we'll back up and go from the top here in a second. John 21, verse 15, and it says, so when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these? The last connection Peter had, now we'll go back and start in verse 1 in a minute. The last connection Peter had with Jesus, this is after the resurrection. The last connection Peter had with Jesus was when he looked right at him after he had heard the rooster crow twice. How many know that was a heavy, heavy situation? It's one thing to mess something up, and it's another thing to mess something up when somebody's watching. They ever fall down on the ice in a Walmart parking lot? How fast can you get back up and look around and see if anybody saw you? Amen? I can't stand to work on something when somebody's watching me when I screw up. We all like people to watch us when we're doing good. Amen? Look at me, look at me, look at me. And when we screw up, don't look at me, don't look at me, don't look at me. But could you imagine, just get with me with Peter for a minute this morning. You think about there with Jesus, and Jesus is going through all this stuff with the crucifixion. And here is Peter standing by a fire. And people start saying, hey, you're one of them, aren't you? You run with him. And Peter says, no, I'm not one of them. I don't go to that church. I don't know those people. That's not my friend. Yeah, I'm pretty sure you are. You look like him. You talk like him. I've seen you before. I've seen you with him one other time. No, that's not me. And then a little girl looks up and she says, sir, you're one of them. And he gets mad, and the rooster crows. And he looks up, and the very one he denied is looking at him. That's heavy. That's screwing up. Amen? Could you imagine what he felt like? Peter had really messed up. He denied even knowing Jesus. It's one thing to kind of lay low with somebody, but it's another thing to deny being associated with someone, especially Jesus. How many have ever had friends go through a rough time in their life, and you watched other people who were supposed to be their friends leave them? People who have blessed other people, people who have run businesses, or people who have done great things for so many other people, whether it's they helped them, whether they blessed them, whether they spoke into their life, whether they provided jobs for them, a company that somebody worked for, and then the leader of the company or somebody begins to go through something terrible and something bad happens to them, and how fast people just scatter. I've watched this over and over in my life. You know, I want to tell you this morning, don't turn your back on people in those times. Don't turn your back on people when they're going through a hard time. Why? All kinds of reasons why. Amen? Do you like people turning their back on you when you go through a hard time? No. You want somebody that'll stick with you. You want somebody that won't leave you. Even when you're stripped naked in front of everybody and you've been beat almost to death and you've done nothing wrong, you don't want people that are just going to join in with the rumor mill or the crowd and, hey, I heard something about so-and-so. They look like they're losing weight. I heard they got cancer. Or I heard so-and-so wrote a hot check. I think they're having financial problems. And you just kind of get and go with that crowd and go with those people and begin to just leave. And instead of saying, no, I know these people. And even if they did, there's got to be a reason. I'm going to go call them and find out what's up. I'm not going to call them and say, hey, no, I'm going to call them up and I'm going to say, listen, is everything okay with you? Are you all right? I just, you've been on my mind. Can we come see you? Can we go out to eat? Can we just be with you? Can we be there beside you in whatever you're going through? I want you to know, no matter what you're going through, I'm with you. How many like somebody like that in your life? My question is, are you going to turn your back on people in those times? I've watched over and over in my life as people who have blessed others many times over in all kinds of different ways. And the minute they go through something tough, people turn their back on them and walk away and just leave them. And it's sad. It's so sad. We talk about children at the border and all the things that we go on social justice today and how could we do certain things to certain people, but yet we turn around and do the most just unbelievable things to innocent people, neglect certain people. But think about doing this to Jesus. And then I hear the scripture in my head where Jesus said, whatever you've done to the least of these, you've done it unto me. I think of the unborn children that are murdered on a daily basis through abortion. And then we worry about a few at one particular spot for some kind of political gain. But yet we can butcher thousands of them and nobody bats an eye. And Jesus said, whatever you've done to the least of these, you've done it unto me. Have you ever turned your back on Jesus? Anybody in here ever turned your back on Jesus, just walked away? We've all sinned, the Bible says. We've all done it. We've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But we pick out people like Peter so many times in Scripture, and we get mad at him, or we beat him down because he turned his back on Jesus. He was afraid. When he got under pressure and all the people started coming, I mean, think about the pressure he had. He has just watched them beat Jesus to a bloody pulp, and he knows they're going to kill him. How many of us could really stand up right there beside him and say, yep, I'm with him. You're going to kill him, kill me. Peter had said that to Jesus just shortly before this. He said, they kill you, they're going to have to kill me. I'm going with you. I'll go with you even to death. And Jesus said, matter of fact, Peter, before the cock crows, you'll deny me three times. And now Peter is standing in the truth of Jesus' prophecy. And he has to look in those eyes. Peter hasn't even seen Jesus other than a couple times after the resurrection, where Jesus just showed up. But as far as Scripture is concerned, we have no proof that he even spoke or acknowledged Peter. Could you imagine if you're the one who has denied Jesus three times and you're with the disciples and you're hiding and you're scared and Jesus just whoop walks through the wall and shows up in your room? I'd be like, I'm over. And as far as we know, the Scripture hasn't ever referred that they had a conversation until now, where we're going to go this morning. Now he's went back to what he knows. After this dreadful thing that he's been through, he watches the guy that he thought was going to save the world and take over Rome and do everything that he thought in his own mind that Jesus was going to do, and it didn't turn out that way. And so God didn't work like he thought he was going to work. So he said, well, forget it. I'll just go back and do what I was doing in the first place. I do know how to do this. I wondered how many times he thought about when he got back on that boat and he went to throw the net the first time. I wonder if the words of Jesus were still ringing in his ears when he said, Peter, I'm going to make you fishers of men. When he went, whew. I wonder if those words, I don't know about you, but when I've screwed up, words haunt me. My screw up just is rolling like a movie in my mind, and it's overplayed. If I don't watch it, and I feel like such a failure, and the things that I've done wrong, and all this stuff, I would just wonder when he threw that net, I'll make you fishers of men. He's like, oh, how could I have denied him? What if I'd have fought more? What if I'd have, I don't understand this. He goes back to doing all that he knows. So I'll just go back to doing what I did before. You know the story. Jesus shows up on the beach and tells them, try one more time. And they do. And they catch a whole boatload of fish. Pun intended. Actually, too many to handle. Have you ever had God bless you to the point you had too much to handle? You had to spread it around a little? Don't go there with me. But how many know when God blesses you, the Bible says that I'll pour out a blessing on you. There's not room enough for you to contain it. There's a reason for that, because he wants to pour it out on everybody. Amen. He's not about just making you all blessed and happy and all that. He wants to pour that blessing out on you so you can bless other people. That's why we're blessed, is to be a blessing. Amen. And so they catch all these fish, too many, and he has to the other guys to get their boat, and they bring it in, and I'm paraphrasing this whole story. There's actually too many for them to handle on their own, so they get to shore, and it's Jesus. Let's pick up in this story. Chapter 21, verse 1, we'll read down to verse, I believe, 17. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias, And in this way, everybody say this way, he showed himself. We've been talking on Wednesday nights. We just started this week. I got on a topic. I was talking about all the things that Jesus didn't say. And I was kind of coming at it from the angle on Wednesday night that, Jesus didn't say that. It's kind of like where we try to say things and claim God said it, or we quote little phrases that sound King James-ish. Or I call them King James-ish. That sounded a little King James-ish. And we quote a little saying or something, and we act like it's out of Scripture that Jesus said it, or somebody will say, you know, yeah, Jesus said that, didn't he? And three people go, yeah, I think so. And so I was coming at it in the beginning of that like Jesus didn't say that. A lot of stuff that's getting preached or people assume or think just after it goes through a bunch of people, then we blame it on Jesus. But Jesus never did say that way. And so that's how I was coming at this series. And then right in the middle of my study, he began to deal with me about what he didn't say. But he did. How many know your actions speak louder than your words? Right? And I begin to look and see and the difference between the Apostle Paul's teaching and Jesus' teaching. Jesus' post-crucifixion, when he's in the earth, up until the time of crucifixion, up until the time of crucifixion, he's still under the law. He's still living according to the law and doing things in a lot of ways that way. This is pre-salvation opportunity. Amen? And so he ministered a certain way. So if we pull out the way Jesus ministered pre-cross, how many know we are trying to minister under an old covenant? But when Jesus went through the crucifixion and was resurrected, we need to look at how Jesus ministered after the resurrection, because this is the side of the cross that we're on. Are you with me? Now we're operating under a new covenant. And I begin to see that Jesus did some things after the resurrection, because he doesn't just come back one more time. He comes back several times in the New Testament. He appears. He shows up. How many know he'll show up a lot more often than we realize? Not just one day, someday in the future, Jesus is going to show up. How many, he shows up in your life every single day. He's living and operating through you because he's in you. And he appears in our lives. And so I felt like the Lord told me to just look at the times, the first several times that Jesus just showed up after the cross or after the resurrection. And what did he do? What did he say? It's very interesting. Go back and watch Wednesday night. I'm not going to preach it again. Y'all should have been here. Okay. So in doing that, we get to this point. This is, I believe, the third time that Jesus shows up after the resurrection and just appears. These guys have given up. Peter said, well, I'm just going to go back to fishing. My whole world got wrecked. I don't know what else to do. And so he goes back to fishing. And the other guy said, well, I guess we'll just go with you. So he goes back to fishing, and Jesus just shows up on the beach. They're tired. They're professional fishermen. They have fished all night. They know how to do what they do. And then some joker over on the beach that they don't even know who he is starts giving them instruction. How many like getting instruction from somebody who's never done what you're doing? Anybody hang wallpaper? I'm not going to tell any more about that story. Other than back in the day when Cassie and I first got married, the worst fight we ever had in our life was over wallpaper border. We waited nearly 30 years before we tried it again. I still need Jesus, is all I'm going to say. I hate somebody watching me when I screw up. Have I told you that before? So here they are, and so then this joker on the beach starts telling about fishing, and so they do, and then, whoa. You know what's even worse about somebody who doesn't know what you're doing or how to do what you're doing, and they give you advice, and you're mad, and then you do what they say? You know the worst part about it is? When it works. Honey, don't you think you ought to put some glue right there? I got this. You walk back in a few hours later, and the wallpaper's hanging off the wall. And she looks at me like Jesus did with Peter. I said I wasn't going to tell on myself, but I did. It's funny now. It wasn't funny. They catch all these fish, and here they come to shore. And while they're doing all that, John looks over at Peter, and he said, I think it's Jesus. That sounds like Jesus. Peter's like, no way. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's Jesus. I know his voice. I'm the closest to his heart. You know that. I laid my head on his chest. Remember that? I'm the guy that knows Jesus' heart more than you, Peter. That's Jesus. And Peter's like, I'm going to find out. So he jumps out of the boat, runs up there, and there's Jesus. Could you imagine? Could you see him coming through the water? Have you ever seen a little kid coming through the water and it's up like this deep and they're trudging, trying to get through it? And he swam and then he stands up and he gets closer to the edge and then he gets up and he sees it's Jesus. We hadn't talked since that last time you looked at me when I denied you 3 times. I bet he slowed his roll when he got to the shore, don't you? I was kind of looking for, I think I'd have left my net here somewhere. Go ahead. Simon Peter and Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, and the two others of his disciples were together, a whole bunch of them. And Simon Peter said to them, I'm going fishing. And they said to him, we're going with you also. And they went out and immediately got into the boat, and that night they caught nothing. But when the morning had now come, Jesus stood on the shore, and yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. This happened in all the other instances we talked about on Wednesday night. They didn't realize he was in the room. They didn't realize it was him until he did something. Then Jesus said to them, children, have you any food? Catching any? They answered him, no. He said to them, cast your net on the right side of the boat. Everything's changed now, if I could paraphrase. Fish a different way now. You're in the new covenant, not the old. Do you see it? There's always more in what he's saying, but there's even more in what he does. So they cast, and now they were not able to draw it in because of the multitude of fish. How many would like to do ministry or do what God's called you to do to the point it was so much you couldn't handle it and you had to get people to come help you and hire people? Amen. That's New Covenant side of stuff. That's fishing on the right side of the boat. Now, are you with me? Whole different story now. So they cast. I'm sorry. And therefore, that disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it's the Lord. And now then Simon Peter heard it, that it was the Lord, and he put on his outer garment, for he had removed it. And he plunged into the sea. But the other disciples came in the little boat, for they were not far from land, about 200 cubits, dragging the net with fish. Thanks, Peter. We got them. You go see if it's Jesus. I just told you. Could you see John? I told you it's Jesus. Thanks. We got it, Peter. Go sit on the bank. Wait for us. And then as soon as they had come to land, they saw a fire of coals there and a fish laid on it and bread. And Jesus said to them, bring some of your fish, which you have caught. And Simon Peter went up and dragged the net to land full of large fish, 153. That's specific, and we'll deal with that some other time. You've probably heard it. And although there were so many, the net was not broken. How would you like to fish or do what God's called you to do and have your net not break? Jesus said to them, come and eat breakfast. And yet none of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? I think, you know why? I think none of them asked. Because they all felt just like Peter. Because your Bible and my Bible says that they all left him that night, except John. They all fled, but we beat up Peter. And we beat up Judas. None of them dared ask him who you are, knowing that it was the Lord. And Jesus then came and took the bread and gave it to them, and likewise the fish. This is now the third time Jesus showed himself to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. So when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, everybody say, had eaten breakfast. I wonder if that was a quiet breakfast. You ever done somebody wrong and then they come back and feed you? You ever walked out on somebody and then they turned around and come back and poured grace back on you? You ever talk behind somebody's back and then have them just come up and love you? It's kind of like, well, I'm not going to do that one. Stay with me. There's very key things from here on out. So when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus turns to Peter and he says something. How many know if you had fished all night, you had been beating yourself up for a long time, you would feel so bad when you walked up to talk to Jesus, it probably would be a good idea to go ahead, and if you're Jesus and you're going to go ahead and deal with some issues in Peter's life, it'd probably be a good idea to go ahead and fill his stomach first. See, we're so quick sometimes as Christians to try to tell people what they need. What they need to hear, try to give them a scripture, trying to give them seven verses of what would fix their life and these kinds of things. And how many know it's really smart sometimes just to go ahead and feed their hungry belly first? When Cassie and I were doing kids' church in another place, we had a lot of kids come in that were from lacking communities, so to speak, distressed homes. And they would not eat a lot of times from Friday at school till Monday at school. They wouldn't eat all weekend. So Sunday morning, how many know they're getting pretty hungry? And we would have them come in, and their parents never came with them. They were what you would call street kids or city kids. They would come in, and we're trying to minister to them and tell them about Jesus. And they're so hungry, they'd eat crumbs off the floor. And so the first thing we realize is we need to feed them first. And so we would feed them and just give them food and just love on them, and then we would tell them about Jesus. I mean, that's New Covenant stuff right there. I'm not going to give you the letter of the law. That kills. I'm going to love you first. I'm just going to love you. I'm going to feed you. I'm going to bless you and do that. That sounds like Jesus. That's what he does right here. He doesn't even deal with Simon until after he feeds him breakfast. And this is key because he's going to ask Simon to do something for him. God will never ask you and I to do something for him that he's not already done for us. We love because he first loved us. We give because he gave. We do because he did, right? There is nothing that God will ever ask you and I to do that he hasn't already done for you. And I'm here to wake some people up this morning with this. Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these? Who's the these? We have to ask the question, is it the disciples? That's who most people think about when he says, do you love me more than these? Because those are the guys that Peter said, I love you more than anybody else. I'll die for you. Peter's like, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And he said, feed my lambs. Keep going. So he said to him again a second time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? And he said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And he said to him, tend my sheep. And he said to him the third time, everybody say three, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? And by now Peter's being grieved. Wouldn't you be? It's like, how many times are you going to poke me with this? This hurts. Do you love me? And Peter was grieved because he had said to him the third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. And Jesus said, feed my sheep. I want to stop right there. Wednesday night when we talked about these times that Jesus showed up and not what he said, but what he did. He showed love. Paul would teach theology, but Jesus would do love. It's not that Jesus didn't know theology or Jesus didn't know the Word. How many know he was the Word? He was the Word in the flesh. Paul comes along in the New Testament and he's teaching theologically. He's got deep truths. He's got the scriptures everywhere they can be found and all that stuff. And he's this great teacher. And God wanted him to be that because he wrote most of the New Testament. We understand that. But Jesus was more powerful to me because he showed love. Jesus loved first. Sometimes the best thing you can do to people to minister to them is feed them, help them, listen to them. How many know that there's times in your life when you don't need somebody to fix it for you, you just need them to listen to you? I just need somebody to listen to me. That's what happened with the woman at the well. Jesus just sat down and had a conversation with her. She wrecks the whole town. A revival breaks out, and churches have sprung up because of this, because he listens to somebody. He just talks to a woman. There's times in our life we just need to listen and not talk. We just need to love without expecting anything in return. We just need to feed somebody. We just need to give somebody something. Just help somebody. Give them an encouraging word. That is ministry first. And I know this sounds basic to some of you, but stay with me. We're gonna dive in here a second. Jesus did ministry after the resurrection. It's not always about what sometimes you say, but the difference is just to love people first. Jesus asks him, "Do you love me more than these?" I don't think it's just about the other disciples, though. Of course, to Peter, he would have thought of that. But at the same time, remember that Peter has left and went back to doing what he did in the first place. He went back to his business. He went back to what he knew before Jesus came, because that's what he was doing when Jesus showed up the first time. Everybody say redemption. That means he's going to come back and put you back. He's going to go back where this all started. He goes back to where it all starts. Peter's fishing. Jesus shows up. And he said, matter of fact, come follow me. I'm going to make you fishers of men. And Peter went with him. And now he's back. Peter's given up. He's went back fishing. And Jesus shows back up where he's fishing. And he starts talking to him. He said, hey, do you love me more than these? I don't think he's asking him just about the other disciples. I think he might be asking him if he's willing to give up what he was willing to give up in the first place. I can't help but wonder if he was asking him about his career. It hits kind of hard. And I knew this would be a heavy message today, but he had went back to fishing. So it begs to consider that Jesus could have been asking Peter, do you love me more than fishing? And all the fishermen are hating me right now. That's not what I'm after. Stay with me. Jesus drills down on Peter right here. Not to beat him up or beat him down, but he drills into this thing deep. And Peter must have thought, ouch. He had to have. And he says, Lord, after the third time, he's like, Lord, you know I love you. People get so hung up with the meanings of the word love right there in the three times that he asked him, do you love me? That there's a difference in the word love right there. And a lot of guys have preached that for years, and I've preached it, and I'm not against that. There is a difference in the way Peter answered him back. He asked him, do you love me this way? And Peter said, I love you this way. You know, I don't love you that much, in other words. But there's more in this than this. Jesus asks him three times. I don't think it's an accident that that's the same number of times Peter denied him. It's still fresh on Peter's mind. I denied him three times and he asked me three times. How many know there's a grace for every single sin? There's a grace for every single mistake, and Jesus is very detailed with Peter's life. He's not doing this just to restore Peter. He's doing this for you and I. He's doing this to show us years later that he still will come and redeem and restore people back, but he's going to deal with every detail. He's going to clean the mess up. He's going to help you fix the mistake. It's almost as if Jesus is saying, I'm here to do something in your life, Peter, and I want you to understand that I'm going to dot every I and I'm going to cross every T in this. We're not going to leave anything untouched. Because how many know when you restore something or you redeem something, that means you go buy it back and then you restore it and you restore it back to its original condition even better than it was before. Most of you know a little bit about the redemption truck that we've started through this church and as a ministry out of this church, that God dealt with me about fishing the streams of recreation. The people aren't fishing the streams of recreation. Just being in places where there's recreation going on and doing ministry there. Not coming in with my word and coming in with all this scripture and my 7 points and clothes or whatever it is to try to reach people. We just come in like Jesus, unannounced. They didn't even realize we were there until all of a sudden the love of Jesus flowed out of you into somebody and they're like, whoa, I think that's Jesus. That's post-resurrection ministry. I call it a sneak attack. Jesus said we're supposed to be harmless. Wise as serpents, but harmless as a dove. We're sneaky. That's why it's not wrong to be sneaky. Unless you're doing something bad. We sneak in, and then all of a sudden they realize we're in the middle of a conversation about my life, and I didn't even realize it. And so he dealt with me about this truck. And so I get this truck. It's out in a field. It's been put off out in the weeds, out by the trees, just to leave and to rot. It's got rat stuff, manure, as deep as the floorboards, clear to the bottom of the seat, full of this thing. Every fender, every body panel on this thing's beat to death. It has been used hard and run over, put up wet, however you want to call it, like an old horse, its whole life. It was an electric company truck. Then it became a farm truck with a bale bed on it. They built this big old catch pin, and they mounted it to the front bumper, like a square steel pin that was on a hydraulic cylinder on the front end of it that would raise up like this, and they would chase cows down in the field and then set that over the cows and catch them. Could you imagine going across the field with a bale bed on the back and this big pin on the front, and you're chasing this cow, and then you drop this pin? And they use it all up, and then they just throw it out in the weeds, and God has the audacity to tell me, go get that truck and restore it. Thanks. No, not one that's just kind of out here that's got a kind of a straight body and doesn't need a lot of work. No, you get one that is demolished and drag it out of the field, and I want you to take it apart, strip it down to the frame, sandblast the frame. We're going to redeem this. We're going to restore it all the way back up, and then I want you to use that for a ministry tool. And I'm excited. I've always wanted to do one, but I didn't want to do one that bad. And so we're going to be pushing that or putting that out there very shortly. It'll have its own Facebook page and stuff like that. But that's where this truck was. It was left out in the field just to die and to rot. I felt so strong. He kept me up in the night last night. And I'm weeping at 1:30 this morning, and he's beginning to tell me this and to preach this stuff. And so I'm going to come right in your field this morning like that old truck. I'm talking to somebody specifically. I saw 5 different faces last night in names, and I can call you out if I need to. Some are in other states and other places. Some are sitting in this room right here today. But I'm here to tell you God's what got your number, and he's coming after you, and he's coming out in your field to whoever it is. And if it's not you this morning, start praying for them. Would you do that with me? Because there's something happening today, and it's heavy. I know, because I am up in the middle of the night. I was so tired anyway, but I am weeping in the night. And you feel like you've been left for dead, left to rust out and rot away, but I'm telling you, he's coming for you. He's coming to get a hold of you and drag you out of the field like we did that truck and put you in and begin to take you apart and get down to the broken things. And he's going to do just like Peter. And he says, you may have denied me 3 times, but I'm going to ask you 3 times. You may have left me this way, but I'm going to show up this way. You may have been broken in this spot, but I'm going to heal that spot. And I'm going to get down to every last detail of your life, because he is a God of redemption and restoration. I heard him say, tell the people, I'm going to heal you. I'm going to make sure every single mistake is dealt with. I'm going to look you right in the eye to do it. How many like to have Jesus look you right in the eye after you've made mistakes? You should be saying, yes, I would, because I know who he is now, and I know he's not mad at me. I know he's not coming after me. He's coming after me in a good way, not to hurt me. Amen? I want to look into his eyes. I want to see what's in his heart. How many know in the midst of a time when there was nothing but a mean, bad God, Noah looked God right in the eyes, and he saw grace, and he said, I'm going to build a boat to the saving of my house. Why? Because he saw grace was in God's eyes. Grace has been in God's eyes from the foundation. Grace was in his eyes. That's why Noah saw it. That's why Noah got out of the situation that was destroying the rest of the world. He's over there building a boat, people making fun of him, and he's just going, you don't know what I saw. You don't know what I saw in his eyes. I saw grace in his eyes, and it gripped me because all I've ever known is this mean God, and he's coming to get everybody, and he's doing this stuff. I saw grace in his eyes, and it caused me to prepare and to build a house and to put structure into things that it may have not ever been done before, but I'm just listening to the voice, and I'm hearing and doing what he tells me to do, and God is going to save my house. Who would like your house saved? Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? And then he takes it one more step. And he says, if you do, feed my lambs, feed my sheep. He didn't ask him to do something that he hadn't already done for him. Such detail. It's the little things. It's those things that Jesus does. It's like, how could I not go feed somebody when he just fed me? And he didn't need to feed me. I didn't deserve being fed. I denied him. I lied that I even knew him. I. How could I not take care of them? See, this is powerful to me, this story, because this is the one God used on me. He dealt with me to start ministry and to do and to feed. I'd ran from it till I was 28 years old because I didn't want to be a preacher. I saw what my perception of a preacher did and had to go through and how they lived, and I wanted no part of that. But one night I was kneeling down, I was praying, and God began to deal with me, and he said, I want you to do this. And I was scared, and I had started to do it, and then I chickened out. I'd vacillated back and forth, and it's just like, fine, I'd stepped out in faith and quit my job and done all this, and I'd just been broke, and things were hard, started a corporation, which is now the corporation this thing is running under, back in 99, and all this stuff. And then I give up, and I'm just going to go back and do construction. And I kneel down to pray one night, and he said, I want you to go to a certain church in a certain state, and I want you to go there this Sunday morning, and I want you to go with somebody you don't even like, and I want you to go there. I'm going to speak to you. Nice. Got to go 12 hours, didn't have the money, had to go with a guy I didn't really like that much because he was rude and obnoxious, and I hated being in public with him. I liked the guy, but I didn't like that part of it, right? And so you know the story. We go, preacher calls me out, speaks specifically to me. You know what he preached that morning? Peter, do you love me? So I go back home. It's like, yeah, that was good. That was probably God. Little time goes by. Happens again. I get to the place where this ain't working. It's not going to, it doesn't matter. And I'm praying, and the Lord speaks to me, and he says, I want you to go. I never forget. He said, I want you to go to Henrietta, Oklahoma, to the Assembly of God Church tomorrow morning, and I'm going to speak to you. It's like 3 hours from where we lived. Wife and little kids again. It's like, seriously? Why do I got to go to places I don't even know? So we get in the car, and we drive to Henrietta, Oklahoma, pull into the Assembly of God Church. They don't even have a pastor. They're in between pastors. They got a fill-in guy. You know, guess what he preached? Peter, do you love me? Feed my sheep. A little more time goes by. I think we're 2 years down the road now. Cassie, could you come? A little more time down the road, and I'm going through this situation again, and it's like I'm ready to give up. It's not working. I don't know what to do. I've lost everything. Everything's went to crap in my life and all this stuff, and I've got this friend named John, and I stopped by his house one day, and he said, hey, come in here. I want to show you something. We sit down, and he said, I want to show you the last message my dad preached before he died. I said, okay, that'd be fine. He gets a DVD out, plugs it in, throws it up on the TV. His dad was to the point in his health, he was so weak, they backed him up and leaned him up against the stage so he could stand up. This is how this guy's preaching. He's holding on to a podium. Last time he's going to preach before he dies. He wanted to preach so bad. He preached all these years, and he's this old Indian man, and he's hanging on that pulpit, and he looks right in that camera. He said, Peter, do you love me? Then he'd say, do you know him? Do you know him? If you and I will check our lives out, God has already done in our lives the very thing he's asking us to do. He already provided, the Bible says. That's a scripture. He's already provided. And we always think about stuff. No, he's already provided the analogy. He's already provided the scenario. He's already provided for you, so you do what he did for you. Does that make sense? I'm not sure who I'm talking to today, but I know God's got a hold of somebody's ear this morning. I feel it so strong. I've been there. Trust me. I took a trip 2 different times. I just told you that story 3 times. As a matter of fact, I had to do it. He said, Peter, do you love me? I need you to feed my lambs, feed my sheep. And you may say, well, I'm not a preacher. It's fun to feed lambs in the natural. My grandkids have some. They're just little innocent lambs, and you get a bottle and you just feed them, and they just wag their tail, and they just, and they're sucking on the milk all the time. And that's fun. It's that way at certain times in ministry too. But this isn't just about preaching. It's about supporting and feeding, or the feeding of sheep, which God referred to people as sheep, right? Don't quit me. Give me 10 more minutes. Some of you here today come and eat all the time. You never help, you never give it all. Just walk in, let God feed you, encourage you, and then walk right out the door. Some of you online, and I'm not being mean this morning, just being real. He told me to ask everybody today, do you love me? Do you love me? If so, feed my sheep. Help me do what I did for you. Help me by supporting what I do. Help me get the word out that God had a plan of redemption for everyone. We've all walked away from Him. We've all denied Him. We've all missed it. We've messed up. We've made mistakes. But how many times has He been faithful to you? To speak to you? To come into most hardest times, some of the hardest times of your life, and He just shows up. And He ministers to us. And then yet, when anything good happens, we just take it and do our own thing. I'm telling you, it's time. Hear my heart today. He's been faithful to you. He didn't beat you up. I've never beat any of you up. I just cook you the food. God just keeps cooking it and handing it to you. And He's filling your belly. He's providing for your family. He's giving you healthy bodies in your family and your kids. And He's giving you jobs and opportunities. And He's caused friendship and things to happen in your life just over and over and over. He filled you up. He met your needs in all kinds of ways. It's time to feed His sheep. Some of you need to get signed back up, back there at the table, and get involved here. We need you. He told me we're going to a whole nother level in ministry. When the COVID thing hit, He didn't tell me to back down. He told me to tell the people to go forward. We're going forward. We're going to push harder than we've ever pushed. I don't care. The Bible says when the enemy comes, rises up against us, what are we supposed to do? When the enemy comes in like a flood, God will raise up a standard against it. Tell your neighbor, you're the standard. You are the standard that's rising up. He's rising up in you out of His holy habitation, which is you, not this building. It's you. He's rising up. That word standard there means a literal stop sign. When the enemy comes in like a flood, God will raise up a standard against him and say, whoa, not past here, buddy. No, you're not coming in my house. No, we're not listening to this in my house. No, I'm not going back and living like I used to. No, I'm not going to not help. Yes, I'm going to help. Yes, I'm going to get involved. No, you're not doing this to my kids. Doesn't that sound like God raising up a standard? Instead of when the enemy comes in like a flood. No, when the enemy comes in, there should be a comma right there. Like a flood, God comes and raises a standard. Some of you need to check yourself on what God's called you to do. I'm not saying to quit your jobs. Not everybody does that. And I don't believe God needs that from everybody. But what has He been leading you to do? But you keep trying to go back to something else. See, the end of this thing was the conversion. Everybody say conversion. He redeemed him. Then he restored him. He had told Peter, the enemy's going to come after you, but I've already prayed for you that your strength fail not, your faith fail not. And when you're converted, Peter, I need you to strengthen these other guys. Peter had followed Jesus 3.5 years. He cast out devils. He healed the sick. He'd done all kinds of things, but he hadn't had his conversion until this day on the beach. What made the conversion? The fact that even as bad as Peter had screwed up, God still wanted him. How many times I've denied God, he still wants me. Why do you still want me? God, you know I don't love you that way. You know I quit. You know I gave up. You still want me? That's where the conversion happened in Peter's life. And he went from the guy that was afraid to deny him to the guy who would stand up on the day of Pentecost and 3,000 people would get saved. He became the guy said that if you're going to crucify me, that's fine. You kill me. They killed Jesus. They kill me too. He went ahead and made good his word. He said, I'll die for you. Matter of fact, I can't even die the way you did. I'm not worthy of that. Just hang me upside down. Where'd that conversion come from? That conversion happened on a beach one day where Jesus has filled his belly first. He fed him, give him grace, give him mercy. And he said, I still want you. God's plan for Peter had not changed one bit. As a matter of fact, Jesus knew Peter was going to mess up. He knew you were going to mess up. He knew you'd quit. He knew you'd give up on him. He knew you would screw up. And it needs to be fixed. You know how you can fix it? I'm here to tell you today. He knew some of you, and I'm talking today, we're going to be in a place where you feel like there's nothing left to do but just go back to fishing. You've been in that place. There's nothing left to do but go back to your old life or to go back to what you knew before because, well, God can't use me now. I saw a particular pastor last night. He built a great ministry. And he had a failure. And he's off just... I haven't talked. We weren't ever close. There was not. I just know who. I know him. I know of him. I've been around him a little bit. But I saw him last night, and I just began to weep. And then I began to see face after face after face. Might as well go back to fishing. Might as well go back to what I used to. You can't use me now. I've failed too much. I'm talking to somebody today. I'm here to break that chain of condemnation off of you. I'm here to break that chain that's been holding you because you've made mistakes. God had me up nearly all night. So I'm not here playing games today. Hear me. I'm here to tell you, like my dad did, you better learn how to fix your mistakes. Come on, somebody. Here's how you do it. Are you ready to fix your mess? Are you ready to deal with it or not? I know you are because God talked to me about this. I don't want to call names if I can, but I saw some faces. You can't outrun the grace of God. The giftings and callings of God are irrevocable. They do not go away because you made a mistake. They were put on you before the foundation of the world. He intimately knew you and the plans he had for you. And he created you to fulfill that plan, knowing full well that you were going to trip and fall here and here and here. But all he's asking from any of us is to do what he did for us. You can make it right today by saying the same thing Peter did. God, hear me. You know I love you. I really do. I just had some weak moments. Peter did love him. Peter did deny everything. He sold his business, just walked away from his business and followed him. He saw miracles. He did love Jesus. Did he not? He had to have loved him. But he had a weak moment. He had a time when he got scared. He had a time when things went wrong. He didn't understand what happened, and God didn't beat him up for that. I hear Jesus saying the same thing that he told Peter that morning on the shore. My plan for you is still the same. My plan for you is still the same. You do love me, Peter. Yeah, you do. I knew that from the foundation of the world. That's why I called you. You do love me, Peter. I knew it a long time ago. And you can and you will do what I've planned a long time ago for you to do. All you need to do is allow this conversion. And it happens when you realize he still wants you. He still wants you. Stand with me if you would this morning. We're going to do something that we haven't done in a long time and needed to be done a long time ago. We put these altars back up here because I still believe in altars. I still believe in a place where we get in our life where we lay our life down and we say, God, not my will, but yours be done. Because his plan and call for you is stronger and better and a better life than you could ever do on your own. Amen? It's better. And I want to open these altars this morning. If you need to go, if you want to go, this isn't for you. I ask you to continue to pray for those that it is. Because I know there's people watching online that need to hear this specifically. And it's all I can do not to call your names. But these altars are open and I want you to come down here and pray. Those of you that need to pray. You say, why do I have to do it? I don't know. God told me to put the altars out here. And he said to have people come and pray. So that's what we're going to do. Amen. I want you to know he still wants you. He still wants you to do what he's called you to do. Some of it is to run a business. Some of it is to do to get into politics. God knows we need people in politics. Some of you have you started that way and then you give up and went back. Or you went through something. It may have been a divorce. It may have been something in your marriage that way. And you just said, God can't use me anymore. Oh, yes, he can. God's stronger than a relationship. God's stronger than a failure in business. God's stronger than any other thing. His giftings and callings are irrevocable. They're not going away. All that we need you to do is accept it and know he still wants you. Amen? Would you bow your heads this morning? Heavenly Father, I have preached what you showed me last night. I thank you that your word is true. There is no variation. And every minute detail of our lives, you're dealing with. You're restoring. You're getting clear down to the bare metal. You're going to sandblast all the paint and all the covering and all the protection that we put over our very framework. And you're going to restore and you're going to renew and you're going to put it back together again. Just like the thief on the cross who said, would you remember me? And how that word means put me back together again. And you said, hanging from that cross today, you'll be with me in paradise. Father, I thank you because you're calling people back to repentance. You're calling people back to changing the way they think and to realizing. I see somebody jogging down a dirt road and just stopping. You're going in one direction and you're going to turn around and you're saying, I'm coming back. I'm coming back to what he's called me to. I praise you for your presence. I praise you for your goodness, your mercy, and your grace, and your spirit. And I pray thy kingdom come, thy will be done in the lives of your people. We give you the praise for it because you never gave up on us. I speak life into every gifting and calling, every idea that you've placed in people's hearts and minds to do. I speak life to that. We call forth and declare it to rise up within your holy habitation. I thank you that your word is what breaks the chains. It's your word that restores and renews and brings back. And it's all by your spirit. And I give you praise that it's done today. And we call it done in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We can thank you. Those of you that watched online, I ask you to just turn it over to God. Go back to what he's called you to do. Your gifting and calling has not left you. It is right where you left it. And God heals and restores and delivers, and he will set you back up in ways you never imagined before. I promise you. Thank you, and God bless you.